Hello and welcome back to Offspring Magazine, the podcast. I'm your host, Srinath Ramkumar. And with me again today is Nikolai Herman.
Hi, everyone.
So you guys saw us at the general meeting. So you know how our faces look because you already knew how our voices sound. So I hope you guys enjoyed it as much as we did. We really found the discussion very lively and energetic. And thanks a lot for everyone who joined the general meeting. It was a pleasure meeting all of you, and I think Nico would agree with this.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, thanks to the general meeting group who made this all work out with less technical difficulties than I imagined, actually. So, no, it was really great.
Whoa. What do you mean by that? That's an inflammatory statement, Nico.
I mean, you always know that these meetings have some difficulties, and I think we only had one, if at all.
Yeah, there were.
So it was really great. Yeah.
I completely agree. There were a few which were spread out, and each one was a unique technical difficulty. And we have to appreciate the general meeting group. They really did an excellent job at handling these in the short amounts of time that they had to deal with these problems. So,
yes.
Excellent job done there. Oh, oops. Excellent job done there by the team. And hope you guys who are going to organize the next general meeting, hopefully you can have it in person.
Yes,
if not, we can make it a hybrid meeting as well. Anyway, so after this awkward pause, let's get on to the matter of discussion for today, which is a very interesting discussion with one of the new vice presidents of the Max Planck Society. Care to take a gamble at it, Nico?
So, yeah, I mean, so this time we'll interview Klaus Blaum. And it was nice that we could go like all the vice presidents to have this series where we interview them and see what their plan is for their term. So I'm really looking forward to speaking to him, and I hope the questions will be somewhat critical, but we'll see.
Of course, you know, we're not going to be very easygoing, and we want to get real answers, and the real answers is what we believe we got from Dr. Klaus Blaum. And, of course, we follow up on tough questions. And if you guys have any further questions for anyone in the hierarchy of the Max Planck Society, please feel free to either write to us or write to them directly. They're usually very open and willing to take questions from students who have some pressing issues which they are facing. Anyway, without any further ado, I believe we can enter into this wonderful discussion with Dr. Klaus Blaum. Dr. Blaum, thanks for joining us on this episode of Offspring Podcast.
So, yes, maybe as a first thing, could you give us a short introduction to yourself and what you are currently doing?
Sure. So, first of all, let me thank you, Nico and Srinath, and your team for this great initiative. It's, in fact, my very first podcast interview, so I'm very much excited about it. My name is Klaus Blaum. I'm a director since 2007 at the Max Planck Institute for Nuclear Physics in Heidelberg and head of the stored and cooled ions division. My research field is precision experiments in atomic and nuclear physics, specifically ultra-high precision measurements of atomic ground state properties like masses, moments, radii. And the field of applications are rather broad, from test of fundamental interactions and their symmetries to the determination of fundamental constants. But I guess the main reason for today's interview is the fact that I'm, since July this year, also the vice president of the chemical, physical, technical section of the Max Planck Society.
Yes, exactly. So this is our series on interviews with the vice presidents that got newly elected. And I mean, one thing that we wanted to ask is, how did you get to your current position? So, I mean, looking at your CV, it looks quite insane, I have to admit. There are like no holes. And I mean, you became a director at a super young age. So could you maybe give us a bit of insight on how this happened?
Yes, indeed. I think my scientific career was somewhat straightforward. So I did my studies as well as my PhD at the Johannes Gutenberg University in Mainz. During the time, I spent a couple of months in a research lab at Pacific Northwest National Laboratory. That's in Richland, the state of Washington. Then I became a postdoc. I decided to continue my research since I was excited about it. And I became a postdoc at the Gesellschaft für Schwerionenforschung in Darmstadt, but I moved right away to CERN, the European Organization for Nuclear Research in Geneva, one of the most prominent scientific stations in the world, I would guess. So, and although I promised my wife to stay there only for 2 years, finally I stayed there for 4 years, among them 2 years at, as a CERN fellow. I think that was probably the most important step in my career path. I returned only briefly to MITES as a young investigator group, so kind of a research group, independent research group, as Max Planck is offering it as well. And only after 2 years, I did my habilitation and became already in 2007 a director at the Max Planck Institute for Nuclear Physics.
Okay, so were there any like situations in your career where you were not so sure, like what you wanted to do as a next step, or was it always decided?
Well, I didn't look too much ahead of the time. So when I finished my PhD, it was not like that I already decided at that time to become a professor. I was always looking only for the next step. So I said, okay, I still feel not the end of my career path. I still was excited about my research. I still was interested in developing new things. So I decided, okay, let's do the next step, which is a postdoc. And then after a few years of postdoc, I said, well, I think it's time now to become somewhat independent, although I had amazing mentors during my time as a postdoc. I think that's one of the most important things, that you have somebody who is supporting you. And then I applied. I was successful. And then from then on, in fact, I never applied. I never applied for the Max Planck director's position. I also didn't apply for the vice president's position. I always got chosen. So it's great.
So my follow-up question on that, because you mentioned you've been a VP for like a few months, like a couple months now. So how has your experience been as one of the new VPs at such a young age for the Max Planck Society? And how much of your weekly time do you schedule to working for the VP position more than your regular scientific work?
Yeah, very good question. And luckily you didn't ask for the number of hours. So I can say at the moment, maybe 50%, 60% or so. But if you would ask for the hours, it's probably 30 hours a week. So you see that my working hours per week are somewhat higher than 40, but that's okay. So the first weeks have been great, although I have been a little bit surprised about the amount of daily business. I mean, that's really amazing, the number of emails you get from many people. But the support I get from the president, from the general administration, my office members, from the institute liaisons, but also from my colleagues at the institutes and at the other institutes, it's really amazing. So it's a great team. I get a lot of support. I have a lot of fun. There are quite a number of tasks which are really science-related, like, for example, now the coordination of the quantum computing initiative, which is really exciting for me, exciting for the section. So although it's a lot of work, I still enjoy.
Okay. So you mentioned before that mentorship is very important. Now that you took on the position as a VP, how does this influence your own lab? So, I mean, can you still put time into the, or give enough time to the people?
Good question. I have to say that at the moment, due to COVID-19, although it has a lot of disadvantages and drawbacks, there is one advantage, namely that we are not traveling, or very little traveling. I haven't had any international travel since five months now, and that gives you a lot of time back. So I can still spend 50% of my time, sometimes 40%, it depends a little bit on the VP tasks, at my home institute, in my lab. I'm still almost daily there. My door's always open. People can simply come in if there is a question. Every day when I'm at the institute, I make my round around the labs. I check how it is going, if there are problems. We do weekly meetings via Zoom to hear how they are doing in this COVID-19 times, if there's anything that is needed, if I can give some help, some advice, and so on. So I think at the moment I still have very close contact, so it's going well.
Okay, so basically the crisis helped to actually stay in contact with everyone while still managing all the tasks. Okay, now this is great.
Absolutely.
Okay, so one more thing that I wanted to ask maybe concerning more your personal life is how easy it was to have a family while having this career. I mean, I assume the workload always increases, and like having a family at the same time, it just takes a lot of time and effort. So how was this experience for you?
It does. And also I promised my wife always that from next year on, the workload will be less. I think I failed over the last 10 or 15 years, to be honest. Always new tasks came up, but I have a wonderful wife, two wonderful kids. They understand that I have to work a lot. On the other hand, whenever I'm needed, I'm there. So I really try to find a good balance between the job and the private life.
Okay. So how did you handle holidays then? I mean, do you just say, okay, now I just take off the time, go away and relax for a bit?
No, not at all. So if we go on holidays, we have the agreement that I'm allowed to check emails for about half an hour in the morning. And an hour in the evening. It's simply, I get typically between 120 and 150 emails a day. So if I would not look into the emails for a week, it's about 1,000, and then it's almost difficult to handle that. So if I check daily quickly, I can simply pass it on either to my secretary or to my assistant, or I can quickly reply, just wait or so. So that helps. But of course, there have to be hours where I can simply focus on my family.
Okay. Well, this seems like a good divide, like because in the mornings, maybe the kids are not as active yet.
Exactly.
Okay, great. All right, then maybe let's get a bit closer to the work of you as a VP. So one thing that I've noticed is that excellence in science is generally like a huge thing. So people are always looking for the best in every topic. And now the problem is, though, for me, I think that the term excellence is not so easy to define. So what would you say is excellence at the different stages as a the career of a researcher? So as a PhD student, what is an excellent PhD student versus an excellent PI and so on?
This is not an easy question. As you mentioned, everyone might have a different definition for excellence. For me, excellence means being a leader in a broad research field, but also being a great tutor and mentor. And obviously, you already mentioned that you should not compare PhD student with a postdoc, nor a postdoc with a young investigative group leader, nor the group leader with a scientist that has already 30 years of research experience. So to be fair, one has to compare the researcher with colleagues in the same age class. And of course, one criteria are results published in peer-reviewed journals. But here, comparisons are rather difficult because there is a different publication culture in different fields. So in my field, sometimes people do the ordering of the authors simply alphabetically. Others put the group leaders last or the most important person first. So what I typically check on the excellence, on the scientific output, is more that I look for the invited talks on the major conferences in the respective field of research. So here you get a quite good overview who has obtained frequently excellent results, who is visible in the research field. So this is for me a very important criteria for excellence.
Yeah, on the PI level, but what would you say for the postdoc and PhD level? So what would you say is an excellent PhD student or an excellent postdoc that, let's say, you would hire for your lab?
Okay, for a postdoc, I would still say I look for invited talks. At least in our field, it's quite common that that postdocs, if they have appeared prominent in publications or so, they get pushed forward by their tutors, by their mentors, and you already get a good feeling for if you attend conference. And that's, by the way, a drawback which we have at the moment with COVID-19, because for me, conferences, workshops, seminars are really important to see who are the best people in their field. Even for PhD students, if I go on a conference and I can hear a PhD student being extremely excited about it, which is for me a sign of excellence, being great in discussions, and I get the chance to talk to her or him afterwards to get a feeling for how deep is she or he in the field. That's something. So having a profound background, having a good knowledge on the basics, as well as a great enthusiasm about the research, I think that's kind of a quality criteria for excellence, and that's true on all levels.
So, okay, then maybe let's move on to one thing that has been recently established in the Max Planck Society are these Max Planck schools. So as far as I know, there's 3 Max Planck schools at the moment.
That's correct.
And so the kind of impression I got is that it's like now a bit of a 2-class system. Like there's the Impress schools and on the other hand, the Max Planck schools. I mean, I understand that it's really necessary these days that you attract the best talent from all over the world. And I think this is the reason for the Max Planck schools. But what about then the other students? Are they like secondary in excellence?
I don't think so at all. I mean, most important is that you provide them, first of all, good working conditions. And I believe we are doing so for all our PhD students, independent on whether they are in a graduate school or not, whether they are in an international Max Planck research school or whether they are in a Max Planck school. I think that what we provide to them, lab access, computer access, facility access, mentoring, I think that's great for all of them. And if not, they should speak up and we will try to improve that. So this is really a promise. The Max Planck schools are a great initiative and across several universities, across several non-university research organizations. I believe this is something unique in Germany, probably even in Europe, but it's only specific for a certain research field. Keep in mind that these schools are rather broad. Too broad for a single university. For example, take the So I think it's simply meant a little bit broader because the Impress they could be somewhat narrower on an institute, while the schools are broader. But I don't think that we do have a first or second class.
Okay, PhD I mean. Students. The reason why I'm thinking that there might be this divide is because of the salary of the PhD students. I mean, as a Max Planck school graduate, you get like 100% funding of this E13, and as a regular student, like the base level is 50. And I think usually nowadays, like depending on the section, you get like a bonus of 15% or a bit more, depending on which institute you're at. So this creates a bit of a divide, because also speaking to other PhD students that are in the Max Planck School versus the ones that are not, it seems they are doing similar things. And that's why, I'm just interested. What your opinion is there?
Yeah, that's a good question. So of course, the salary might depend a little bit on the research field and on the competition, but I fully agree and I'm fighting hard for it, that the salary should be equivalent to, let's say, between 2/3 and 3/4, so 65% to 75% of a TVET E13 wage classification. That's really something which I already proposed a couple of weeks ago to the president, and that's something where I believe we have to improve, also in comparison to universities. I'm since many, many years in the DFG evaluation board, and I see simply that we have to increase there. Whether it's 70%, 72%, 68% or so, I mean, I would say that can an institute decide, but it should be at least 2/3 to 3/4. I still believe that there should be a tiny difference to a postdoc position, since part of the PhD work is dedicated to educational training, lecturing and so on, which is somewhat the educational part. Around this 70% plus minus 5%, I think that would be a fair salary.
Yes, I mean, no, I completely agree. And I mean, in the CPD section, I guess the competition from industry is bigger compared to like the humanities, especially, and the BMS section. It's just, in the humanities, sometimes they still get 50%, which if you live in Munich, is not the best or the highest salary. So
I fully share your opinion. Mm-hmm. Therefore, I said it has to be higher. But you also mentioned there are some research fields in our section, mm-hmm. like computer science. It's mm-hmm. almost impossible to compete yes. with industry. I mean, they are paying a salary which is so much higher than our standard salary that mm-hmm. you have to increase also the PhD salary.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. So from a recent Max Planck report, so it said that around 200 positions for directors have to be filled by 2030. So this like more or less implies that you have to hire almost 20 new directors every year in the next 10 years. So how does this process of appointing new directors work, and how do you think the process can be made faster or more efficient?
Okay, that's a great question, and the answer might take a little bit longer. And the reason for that is that the hiring process takes really long. So if we are fast, it still takes 6 months, but I would say the typical duration of the hiring process for a new director is more in the order of 1 to 2 years or so. So I can briefly summarize it, but that's specific now for our CPT section, because other sections do it differently. So typically the institute starts by looking for a suitable candidate by having either a search symposium, a series of colloquia, or a call for applications. So at the moment, there are like a generic call for applications once a year, but most often institutes do a search symposium or a series of colloquia to look for suitable candidates. And then at some moment, the institute has identified the best candidate, which can already at that moment easily take half a year to a year, sometimes even longer, depending on the availability of the candidates. Now other institutions are also having high salaries, great institutes. So let's say that is done. Then the candidate gets proposed to the prospective committee by the institute, and then the prospective committee looks whether this is aligned with the institute's mission. And if that's the case, the prospective committee says, yes, that's a good candidate, please proceed. And then the candidate gets proposed to the section, and a hiring committee is put in place. And the hiring committee consists of typically 12 to 15 internal and external experts in this field. This committee then meets typically 2 to 3 times. The candidate presents her or himself, as well as the institute presents its view on the future research direction. And then up to 12 or 15 recommendation letters are asked for. So that's already a huge number. And we need at least 10 to come back. So and sometimes you have then to re-ask again. And you have to give the time to the rapporteurs, to the referees. That takes another couple of 6, 8, 10 weeks or so. If that's back, the committee meets again. Then it gets presented to the section, and the section does a vote. And you need at least 80% of yes votes. And if that's the case, then it will go to the Senate, and the Senate will make the final decision. So you see that there are really many, many steps in the hiring process. Nevertheless, we had cases where we managed to do the hiring on a 6 month time scale if everybody works incredibly fast. But typically, I would say it takes 12 to 18 months. But one argument I always like to bring here is that the investment in a director is enormous. Depending on the age, the investment is typically mm-hmm. 100 million euros, which the director will spend over mm-hmm. his or her scientific career. Mm-hmm. So I believe you do well by taking the hiring process yes. very, very seriously.
I think this is very important, yes, as you said. And now, I mean, when you go for these or look for candidates, I mean, trying to find like the candidate with the highest potential is, I mean, I guess already a difficult thing. But then on the other hand, they usually have other job offers as well, right? Because they are like really good in their field already. So what does the Max Planck Society has that others maybe don't have?
Okay, let me start to answer in a little bit different way. First of all, I personally like to hire somewhat the younger generation. As you already pointed out, I was 35 and I haven't had any other offer. I came as an independent group leader. And my institute, by the way, is doing that quite frequently. So the last four hirings were between 34 and 36 years old. So we are rather a young institute, and I think we did well. Nevertheless, sometimes, of course, you try to hire people having more experience simply because they are the leaders in the field. And then it's more likely that they have competitive offers. And one good argument why we can still manage to get her or him is that we have a great environment in general in the Max Planck Society. So it's not only the resources that we can make available, but also the infrastructure. So if you look at the university or so, I believe that most of the universities cannot compete concerning the infrastructure. And being at the buildings, the labs, the mechanical workshops, the electronic workshops, we have high professional superconducting labs, semiconductor lab, the HLL, for example, which others do not have. So I think it's the full package that we can offer that is better than for many other institutions.
Okay. No. I completely agree. Yeah, I mean, just at our institute, it's sometimes very easy to get like something custom made if you need something.
Yes, exactly.
Mm-hmm. So concerning then new fields, because I feel like the Max Planck Society is trying to get into new fields that are not present at the moment. So how does that usually happen? How do you decide, okay, this is a new field, we should invest in this, like, or get like someone that works in this field?
Yeah, that's something which I would like, in fact, to see more often happening, but it's sometimes difficult. So I take the example of The Origin of Life. That was an initiative that came up maybe 8 years ago, and I believe that Max Planck Society was first in doing so. So there were one or two directors that had that idea. We have this kind of perspective committee, and there we have a kind of a wish list. So people can simply drop ideas, and then we are discussing these ideas. And that was one of the ideas which finally, in fact, we failed, because it took us simply too long to start an institute for the origin of life. So it's we are still trying to do so, but the time span of 8 years is too long. Now, very recently, we came up with, in the perspective committee, one of my colleagues came up with the idea of was first called Max Planck Institute for Water. Then it was changed to Max Planck Institute for Liquids. So it's a kind of a liquid initiative. And again, I believe we would be first having really a dedicated research portfolio in the field of liquids and waters. So we hope that we can do that now on a time scale of 1 or 2 years. And that would bring us at least in this field really on at the forefront of research. So it's very often driven by people, that people have great ideas and they get the support by the colleagues, and then it will work out.
Okay, so this is just everyone just putting their ideas out, and then it's discussed, and then if one is good enough or like decided on, then there will be a new Max Planck Institute for that, or?
Not always a new Max Planck Institute. So the process you described is perfectly right. You bring up a new idea and then it gets discussed. It's not only whether the research is exciting, you also have to make sure that you find the suitable people to do this, to do so. Because finally, all it is about people. If you don't find the right directors, the good research field doesn't help you. So it needs to be both a good idea and good people. And sometimes it can be a kind of a new initiative in an existing institute, so that you... For example, my own institute, it's called Max Planck Institute for Nuclear Physics, but the research profile we have is that two directors are working on in the field of astroparticle physics and three directors are working in the field of quantum dynamics. So it's rather different. So you can, even within one institute, you can have two research directions. So it doesn't have to be always a new institute, which is also costly, of course. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I want to switch gears a little bit, because I think we've gone very deep into this hiring process, and I want to just go on with the discussion. So with the podcast and everything, what we're, at least for the Offspring and PhDNet, we've always sought to increase communication and improve the discussion amongst students and, you know, at least get the information out there so people know that it exists. So this is this within the Max Planck Society, increasing communication can be a very difficult task. So how do you want to strengthen the communication between different parties? For example, like in your interview on Max, we didn't find a section which where you mentioned early career researchers. Or so, like, how do you plan to improve this communication between different levels of people, like the PhDs, the postdocs, the directors, and so on?
Yes. First of all, I believe that the communication within the Max Planck Society is not too bad. Mm-hmm. Of course, it can and should be improved. No doubts on that. And but I believe that we do much better than many other research organizations. But still, we have to improve there. I fully agree. The way I plan to strengthen the communication is simply by being a kind of a role model and demonstrating intense communication myself. And to give you one example, that I started when I became vice president, I started to do a kind of inauguration visits to the institutes. So in my section, I have 36 institutes, and I started one by one to visit them. And I always spent a really large fraction of time by discussing with early career researchers, postdocs, PhDs, and staffs. So I make meetings of 45 to 60 minutes with all of them and getting in touch with them, discussing what can be improved, what is my mission, what is my idea, how do they believe, how do they think about this idea, where can we improve. And you mentioned specifically my interview at the beginning of my job. I didn't mention specifically early career researchers, but what I said was that I hope that everyone in the Max Planck Society will see me as a good person to contact. And there, in this everyone, they are surely included. So if they have questions, comments, criticisms or so, they really should feel free to get in contact with me. Drop me a line, send me an email, and I will really try to improve
okay.
that.
No, great. I mean, yeah, it worked out for us. So
exactly. Yeah.
So one thing actually I want to ask there. So we in the neuroscience or with the Neuroscience Institute, we organized a PhD neuroscience meeting last year. And I mean, it was very well received. Every participant was super happy. So it was just a PhD student conference. And we gave talks, had posters, we had a lecture by actually my PI and also a mentoring session with Wolf Singer. And so because one thing that I feel is a bit different in the Max Planck Society is that usually the directors or the PIs get together, they meet, they exchange ideas, but this just happens on the PI level, not on the levels below. I mean, for neuroscience, there's, I think, 20 institutes associated with neuroscience. So getting also the PhD students together was a really great experience for us, also for networking and just getting to know all the people within the Max Planck Society that are all really motivated people. So do you think it would be possible to increase like these inter-institute exchanges also on the PhD level or the postdoc level?
Sure. It, of course, it depends a lot on the initiative by the students and postdocs themselves. I mean, just what you described, I'm pretty sure that you or your colleagues have been the driving force behind it. And then if you come up with such an idea, we will support it. So again, giving you an example from my institute, we have a neighboring institute which is called the European Molecular Biology Lab. And at some moment, my students came up with the idea, well, shouldn't we get to know a little bit more about the other institute and especially about the other PhD students, because we live next door to door, but we don't talk to each other. And then we organized at the first moment a barbecue, and then getting presentations by three PhD students from each side, and it was simply amazing. And since then, there's very close contact about how they are doing, how we are doing, is there something which we can improve by having a kind of a campus-like structure. Also, the other one is not a Max Planck Institute, so it goes really across the boundaries. But you need somebody who is really pushing it. It's very difficult if you push it from the top by the directors by saying, now you have to do it. You need people that are willing to do it exactly how you described it. But I'm absolutely open for that.
Okay. No, I think, yeah, as you said, it's best if like both sides are willing to do this. But yes. I mean, this is amazing, like having a exchange between like a biological lab and the physics lab. This is great. Okay.
Yeah. It's really great. And I mean, there are quite some overlaps. For example, the topic of big data is one example. Because in biology, big data is now really a big issue. But it's the same for our astroparticle physics people. The amount of data collected is enormous. So the techniques to develop in order to see what is the right question you can ask and hope to find in your data is important. And that's true for both fields. And so that's one topic where you can have a really scientific exchange.
Just a small anecdote to add here, because now in our lab, when we do, for example, imaging, like 4D imaging with temporal dimension, we actually use an algorithm which was devised for astrophysics to merge the images together and use it. And although we're doing biology, like beating heart images, but we're using astrophysics algorithms to merge the images together because the image processing is so good. Yeah. Anyway, that was just a little anecdote.
But it's a great example for that you can really talk across the your research fields.
No, okay, so concerning communication, I think there's always one party that we're leaving out right now, which is the public. Now, so that's why I wanted to ask, especially as Max Planck Society, as we're getting mainly funded by the public. I mean, you mentioned that you're doing talks at schools, for example, but do you think that we should increase this and also motivate, for example, early career researchers to go out and talk to the public about these things?
Yes, I was in close contact with Mrs. Beck. She is the head of the communication office, and where I try to really support that. So I'm going between 4 or 5 times a year to schools, and I also do evening talks in theaters, for example, to a public of 500, 600, 700 people, in order to communicate my science to the public. And I think that's really important because what we are using is public money. It's taxpayers' money, and they have the rights to hear about what we are doing. Vice versa, it gives us the chance to motivate people already from the very young age for our science. And therefore, I believe it's really important, and I would like to motivate not only my directors, colleagues, but also our staff members, our early career researchers to devote some time, and it's not too much. As I said, if I do that 4 or 5 times a year, if I go to school, it takes me 3 hours, 4 hours a day. If everyone does that, it will improve a lot.
Exactly. Yeah, no, I mean, there's so many schools, and even the PIs doing it would take far too much to cover all of them. So I thought like increasing the number to the PhDs also and postdocs to give these talks. I mean, as long as they, I guess, speak German, would help. Yeah, would benefit the society to communicate the science and also make sure that the people have trust in science.
Yeah, a bit of a problem with the schools is that they have very little time. So what we try to figure out is often that we can embed it in their regular course. For example, sometimes I talk about the basics of nuclear physics. So nuclear physics is no longer taught in schools, but they can make some 1 or 2 extra hours. Then I talk first a little bit about the basics, and then I'm going to my research field by saying, what do I contribute to this basics knowledge in nuclear physics? And they really like that very much. So I bring some experiments, some smaller experiments where I can demonstrate like the oscillation of a trapped ion and so on. So visualize that, and then the students get really excited about that.
Okay, now that sounds great. Yeah, I mean, one reason why I think the schools are so important is also coming to our next topic, I guess, is gender equality, is that, I mean, especially in the CPT, you see that there's a huge bias towards men. So, like, I think 80% of all people in the field are men. And in order to start early, also to communicate to girls as well, that they can do this, to study physics and so on. I think this is important. So how do you think, could it be possible to increase the percentage of girls starting with physics or studying physics?
Yes, you are addressing a very pressing topic. I think we have to reach more equal gender distributions. I'm convinced that we will do so. The question is at what percentage level and how long it will last. So for me, it's more about that you can reach on a 5 years or so time scale at a specific career level only the percentage which we have one level below. So at the moment, we have, let's say, 5% of female directors, only 10% of female staffs, 15% of female postdocs, and 25% of female students. So within 5 years, you cannot reach 25% of female directors, because that would be well above that what you have on the level below. So for me, it's important that on a 5 years time scale that we reach the level which you have one below. So we have to make sure that we get at the level of 20 to 25% PhD students in the next 5 years or so, because we have 20 to 25% female students. At the same time, we also have to increase the female percentage on the students level. So it has to be a stepwise process. But as you said, it really has to start from the very beginning. It has to start in schools. It has to continue on the university. And then it has to continue in our research institutes.
I mean, how is it when you go to these visits to the schools? Do you find boys and girls equally interested in your topic? Yeah, or is there a bias already?
No, absolutely. I'm convinced that there is, when I talk about my research, that male and female, boys and girls, they are equally excited about it. Yeah, so I'm optimistic that we can improve that, but we have to work hard, and all of us have to help here.
I mean, maybe a more critical question. Do you think that it helped your career that you were a man at some point, or do you think this it was fine the way it is? Like,
I think that's difficult to answer because because I'm not female. I can't say how it would have gone if I would have been a woman.
But I mean, for example, during some talks or some networking sessions, was it like easier to connect to the male or the older people that were in the like scientific community, or do you think that was like the same?
No, I think that is the same. I hope at least. Where I see, of course, a difference is if women give birth, then at least you will be out for a certain amount of time. Maybe not completely out, but it's a load. Men don't have to carry what women do have, and we have to make sure that this load is gets carried by all of us. I know that my wife took quite some load away from me on this topic, but still I tried to help her as much as I can, so that she could also continue her work. And we as at the Institute have to make sure that we provide an environment where we can support to the female scientists to maintain their very high career level.
Okay, so again, switching gears slightly, and I think because I think we get to the depths of every topic, but we cannot go to the bottom of everything because we'll of course need more time than just 1 hour to do the interview then. And so like I want to touch on this one topic which actually originated from one of the CPT section institutes, that is sustainability and awareness for sustainability. So like each institute has its own specific problem, and it's not a very generic issue. And the Max Planck model suggests that every institute has its own independence when it wants to do certain things in certain ways. So how do you, in your opinion, how do you think you can make the whole Max Planck society or all institutes more sustainable and somehow like more compatible with the newer sustainable models that we are getting recently?
Indeed, the independence of every institute makes it difficult to find a common line for the whole Max Planck society. But I believe that by showing best practice examples, like the Energy Commission at our institute that takes care on energy savings, sustainability, etc. And which, by the way, I mentioned in my opening speech in front of the section, I hope that we can raise awareness for this topic at every institute, simply by showing this best practice. And there is already, by the way, since you mentioned this sustainability, there is already a presidential committee on the subject of climate protection in the Max Planck Gesellschaft, suitable measures and their prioritization, headed by Mrs. Rauschek and Mr. Bonhoeffer. And that's what I would like to support and then to show to the section that if we work together on this topic, we can really improve things. But you're right, the independence of the institutes makes this sometimes difficult.
Okay, I mean, one thing that maybe is less institute dependent is, I guess, like some of the administrative work that is happening at every institute. I mean, you were mentioning, for example, that I think it was at your institute that if you just digitalize the submission form for holidays, it could save up to more than 8,000 papers every year, which is a huge amount, I would say. And also you mentioned that something like this is already implemented at CERN for quite a while. So do you think that the Max Planck Society can move this to there as well?
We have to. I think we have to be much more professional also on this administrative level. And I gave this single example of the digital leave requests. At my institute, we could save about 8,000 pieces of paper a year only for the single process. But you can think about many, many more processes like digital travel expense claims. What I had in mind there is why not to use an app similar as for our private health insurance expense claims. I mean, I simply copy them and upload them with an app, and at some moment I get my money back. And the same you could do with a digital travel expense claim. So you do not have to make hundreds or thousands of copies of pieces of paper. Rather to professionalize that. And there are many more, like time correction sheets. So if people have to go earlier to visit the doctor, so at the moment they do it on paper form, it gets copied in the secretary's office, it gets copied in the personal office, and so on. I believe that is not needed if you have it on a digital form.
Mm-hmm. I mean, do you think that maybe because you're younger that you're more behind this instead of like other people that are, because I mean the Max Planck directors are, as many of them are retiring within the next 2 years, maybe on the older side?
Most likely this is the case. I'm a bit of a younger generation, but it's, as said, it's more the being driven by excellence. That comes back now to the beginning of our interview. What's the definition of excellence? That excellence, it's not only enough today to be excellent on the science level. You also have to be it on the administrative level. So if you get people from the outside, you have to show to them that at all levels, being it the infrastructure, being it the administrative support, the scientific support, you have to belong to the best ones. And so this is my motivation why I believe that we have to improve there significantly.
Okay. I mean, one more question towards this digitalization topic. So I feel like there's many tools coming out, software tools that can be used that are like maybe slightly different than the ones that exist now. And it's really hard to know which one to use. And also learning how to program is usually a thing because exactly the thing that you want to do often doesn't exist. So how does it work in your lab? How do you teach the new students coming in what they need to know about like software tools?
Most of the time they are much better than I am, to be honest. So on the scientific level, the digital infrastructure is quite good. Already at the students level, they come in with great ideas. So, for example, since years, we are using already digital lab books like eLog or so. And whenever there's a student, and they search the web, they test themselves new software. And at some moment, they come and say, hey, check, this is really an amazing software. And so really since years, we are using digital lab books, of course, with all the standards which we have to keep in order to save the data for more than 10 years. Of course, we do so. But this digital lab books makes life much, much easier. Everyone can access it. You do not have to copy pieces of paper.
I completely agree. I mean, for myself, especially because my handwriting is kind of bad, I really like that everything is digital now. I can read it like a month from now and so on.
Yeah, you can also easily enter a photo. If I see a nice apparatus, I just photograph it and then I copy it in. If I can make a quick drawing on the notebook and add that to the lab book. I can comment by myself by logging in, so I get access to every logbook of my labs. Then I log in. I can directly comment what the others have written. Did you check that and that and so on? I think that's a great tool.
Okay, I mean, you've mentioned something like big data and open data before. So one thing that is one topic that is more dear to me is open science. And now I just wanted to ask your view on, like, how is it in the CPT section generally, and what do you think? I mean, I guess with these huge collaborations, it's a bit different anyway. If you publish something, do you care about open access and such things?
Yeah, we do. So I would guess that about 90 to 95% of my papers are open access. And in fact, they are 100% open access because we put all my publications on archive. So this is already one form of having it open access. But even later, when the final version gets published by the journal, and there, thanks to the MPDL, the Max Planck Digital Library, they really do a great effort to do this open access negotiations with the different publishers. And even if we don't have an agreement, we publish open access by then paying for it. So I would, as said, I have about 100% of the papers on archive. But of the final versions that get published, I would say about 90%, 95% is open access. So I'm really a big fan of open access.
Oh, that is great. And how do you handle data? Do you also publish this data on some repository? Because, I mean, this is always a bit difficult because they might be huge. And
That we don't do, or mm-hmm. we do it very little. But what we typically write in our papers that by request, we are willing to provide the data. And we are really happy to do so. So as you said, it's a bit of a problem to make it fully open access, but at least we make it available to everyone who's interested in it.
Okay. So how many requests do you get for your data usually? So does this happen on a regular basis?
Not really. So we get from time to time requests by theoreticians. So in my research field, we are doing precision experiments. Very often, we take data over a long period of time, let's say a year or two. And then they are interested in if you see, for example, time-dependent changes in the data. And theoreticians, they really have great ideas what kind of signatures you might see in this time evolution. So they ask if either they check it themselves or they ask if we can make the data available, and we look together into that. So this is mostly that comes up as requests. But you know, it's often also difficult to dig into the data of somebody else, because you have stored it in a form which is difficult to read out. Then you have to explain what kind of information you have stored, in which way it is stored, and so on. So I would say most often we do it then in a collaborative effort.
Oh, okay, I see. So, yeah, I mean, this is like completely, because I feel like many people are afraid that they're getting scooped, for example, if they publish their data. So then, but then, as you mentioned, it's just usually more difficult to look at someone else's data, especially if it's sometimes not exactly the documented the way that you would do it. So absolutely. I'm not sure how valid the claim of it leading to scooping is.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Okay, one more topic, maybe just quickly to scratch on it, would be like China. I mean, as far as I remember, you mentioned that in your interview that you are building a group of, I guess, PIs that are going to tackle the issue. And I mean, recently, I think China overtook the United States in number of publications. So they're becoming really a force to be reckoned with. And also, I think their funding is quite high. So how is generally the collaboration with I guess, Asia? Because one thing that I, in my personal experience, is very difficult is communication. And yeah, how was this for you?
So first of all, when I had my starting interview, I said it's not only China, it's the Asian in general, because I have very good relationships also to Singapore, to India. But as you mentioned, China is probably at the moment the leading country. They have superseded America in the number of publications, in the number of citations. I have collaborations with China in my research field since almost 20 years, and so far only great experience. They are excellent researchers, open-minded. We have very good exchanges. So in order to first get a good overview if we really have problems in a way that, for example, that there is a political influence directly on our research, I would like to call in this kind of board of experts that doesn't have to be only on the director's level. So what I have in mind is really also to call in people on the postdoc level or on the early career researchers level to get the feedback what their experience is. So what kind of collaborations do we have in which field? Surely not only in the CPTS section, but also in the GSHS section, BMS section, and so on, to get, and it might be different for different research fields. So I first would like to get feedback on that, would like to summarize that, and then see how we can handle it. But so far, to be honest, I had only very good research experience, very good collaborations.
Mm-hmm. No, that's great, because I think, it's generally a bit of a difficult topic, because nowadays with the way the world is developing, I feel like it's not that easy to how to assess the whole situation.
It is a difficult topic, and I'm not saying that all is good, but I think it would not be okay to ignore it. I mean, they have 20% of the world's population. So statistically, they have 20% of all papers that get published. That's something which we cannot ignore in science. So we have to deal with it, and I'm happy to take that load. But of course, I also need the support by my colleagues. I need the feedback in order to address these issues. I have very good contacts to the Chinese Academy of Science, for example, which is somewhat equivalent to Max Planck, and surely we'll discuss these topics also with them.
Okay, great. So I just wanted to bring this up, maybe perhaps as a last question. So if we look at the audience for at least our podcast, it's the biggest range is from 18 years to 35 years. So it's basically people in the early academic career phase of their lives. So what would be your general advice to them, and what would you ask them from your perspective to proceed in which direction, so that you know they can have a clue if they are aspiring to be directors or perhaps even the next VP?
My advice would be excited as much as you can about the stuff you are doing, and that's what I did always. If I would not enjoy the job I'm doing, I would simply not do it. So it's always being excited about it. And if you're excited about it, then you're also willing to do the best. You're willing to work harder and more intense in order to get the best output. So that would be my advice. Enjoy as much as you can the work you are doing. If you feel that this is not the right work, then simply don't do it. But if you believe this is the right work, then do it as good as possible, and then you will succeed. I'm pretty sure about it. We have a structure which is absolutely open up to the top, and the best people that really are enthusiastic about the work will succeed.
Okay, so thanks a lot for the interview, Klaus. This was really nice to talk to you.
And my pleasure.
Yeah, I mean, I hope everything works out with the position as a VP. And we'll hear from you in the future, I guess.
Yeah, we wish you luck for the next 5 years as well.
Yeah, and, thanks
we
a lot.
We hope that we get to have more discussions with you perhaps later on as well.
Yeah. Great.
If not us, maybe people who take over from us in the podcast series, at least.
I just wanted to offer, we should repeat it maybe in 2 or 3 years from now, and then we discuss
definitely
again how much I like this job.
Okay.
if things have improved and so on, it would be my pleasure. I enjoyed it a lot.
Okay.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much.
Okay, everyone, I hope you enjoyed the discussion. It was very interesting to have it with him. And I think it was good to get his point of view on these topics, because they might actually be able to change something in the next 3 years. What do you think, Srinath?
Yeah, definitely. So one thing that he mentioned already was that we go back to him and interview him 3 years down the line when he's been able to put some of these points of interest or points of discussion into practice. And of course, they are very new in their roles right now, all three VPs, right? So I think they would need some time to get settled in and start to make some concrete changes. It's going to take some time, definitely. And there are some topics which are, of course, of severe importance to a lot of the PhDs in his section as well as other sections, and there are a lot of things that we can learn from what changes that they're doing in his section which can be translated over to the other sections and other institutes as well. So perhaps we should keep an eye out and see what changes are upcoming, and perhaps have a
It's definitely going to be interesting to see how far they get within their first term, and hopefully we can have the interview afterwards. So yes, this was the first interview of the series of the vice presidents. So we tried to have different questions for all the different vice presidents, and I hope you will enjoy the different topics we'll talk about then.
Of course, Nico is saying this with the fact in mind that the upcoming 2 episodes are going to be interviews with Dr. Asifa Akhtar, the vice president for the BMS section, and Dr. Ulman Lindberger, the vice president of the human sciences section. Anyway, I think people are looking forward to that, and I am looking forward to that, to see what we discussed and how these discussions went. And I'm sure we will have very fruitful and productive upcoming few weeks in the Offspring podcast.
Definitely. Yes, I mean, we'll have 1-2 more episodes, and then this is going to be it for this year.
Yeah, more or less for this season. So anyway, stay tuned, everybody. And this is going to be the peak of our podcasting journeys so far. And we hope to see you all in the next episode next week with Dr. Asifa Akhtar. Until then, it's a bye-bye from me.
And from me as well.
Offspring Magazine, the podcast, is brought to you by the Max Planck PhD student and the Science Communication Working Group known as the Offspring Magazine. The intro-outro jingle is composed by Srinath Ramkumar, and the pre-intro jingle is composed by Gustavo Carrizo. The podcast series is hosted by Srinath Ramkumar, Nicola Herman, Alison Lewis, Adrian LaHoya, and Sandra Fendel. If you'd like to give us any feedback, comments, suggestions, please feel free to write to us at offspring.podcasts@phcnet.mpg.de. And with that, I will see you next week. Stay safe, stay healthy, and bye!